salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down in worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care. So welcome to worship today as we come to bow down in worship before God. Some of you have noticed there are beanbags before you. You do not have to sit on them. They are there if you wish to. As somebody has already pointed out, some of you may not get back up if you get down. So if you feel like the bowing down in worship is going to be more of a metaphorical inner spirit thing, that's fine, then bow down in that way. But we are here to worship the Lord, and so we're going to come into that space as we sing two songs together. Come, all you vagabonds, followed by Come, now is the time to worship.
Come all you vagabonds, come all you don't belong, winners and losers, not people like me. Come all you travellers, tie on the journey, come away while I stay, while welcome you'll be. Questions, looking for answers and searching for reasons and sense in it all. Come on, you fallen, and come on, you broken, find strength for your body and food for your soul. Come to the feast, there is room at the table. Come, let us meet in this place. With the King of all kindness, he welcomes us in. The wonder of love and the power of grace. The wonder of love.
The purpose of human existence was to provide for the gods. We merely exist to make sure that God is fed. Israel's worship, though, was slightly different. It shared many of those external forms that I've just described, even to the point of calling sacrifices the food of God. But its essence was quite different. As the prophets pointed out, God could not be worshipped only externally. To truly honour God, it was necessary to obey his laws, the moral and ethical ones, as well as the ritual ones. To appear before God with sacrifices, whilst flouting his demands for justice, was to insult him. Amos chapter 5, verses 21 to 24, say this: "I hate, I despise your religious festivals. Your assemblies are a stench to me. Even though you bring me burnt offerings and grain offerings, I will not accept them. Though you bring choice fellowship offerings, I will have no regard for them. Away with the noise of your songs. I will not listen to the music of your harps. But let justice roll on like a river, righteousness like a never-failing stream." To worship God through ritual alone is not to worship God. It's not to fully understand what worship is. Fast forward a little bit to the New Testament, and worship still primarily means to bow down. But the word also translates Greek terms that signify service or piety. Once again, serving God, holiness, purity, following those laws of the moral and ethical kind. It is in some way to admit that the person, thing, or deity that you are worshipping is higher, better than you. Which brings me on to my third and final definition of worship for tonight. The old English root of the word worship, which can be summarized as worth-ship. Worth-ship. Being a suffix that indicates a state of being, like friendship or relationship. We are friends. We are in love. Worth-ship indicates then that the person being worshipped is worthy. So what is God worthy of? Alan, can we put my picture up? Thank you. Nothing short of our whole lives. In Romans 12, verse 1, we hear the words, "Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship." Up here is a collection of words that have, at some point through history or still today, have something to do with worship. Which ones resonate with you? Take a moment. Which ones do you naturally lean towards, and which ones do you lack at that make you a little bit uncomfortable? "Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. This is your true and proper worship." Offer your bodies as a living sacrifice. God is worthy of everything. We cannot give enough. God is worthy of much more than just a Sunday morning or a Sunday evening. He is worthy of much more than just a Sabbath day. She is worthy of every day of our lives and more. God is worth our servitude. And it's our servitude, and not just mine and Claire's servitude, that matters. Because it is no longer about the temple or the priests. For we were all made priests the day that the Holy Spirit made its home inside of us. Our bodies became the temples, and our minds and spirits became the priests. Our minds and spirits are to guard the doors, to be wary of what goes in, to be wary too of what comes out, to ensure that our lives are worthy of God, just like the temple was a worthy dwelling place for God. If worship is to be the whole of our lives, the decision we make in every moment, then it makes sense that some of it will be loud and some of it quiet. Some of it internal and some of it external. Some alone and some with others. Some formal and some informal. Eating and fasting, joyful and sorrowful. Giving thanks and lamenting. Some with words and some with none. Clothed in finery and wearing very little in the shower. Giving and taking, largely because worship is about another ship. It is about the relationship between God and us, between God and God's world. There is no right or wrong way to worship. It is what is in our hearts that matters. If God is truly at the centre, and you are expressing in some way a love of God, a thankfulness for all that God has done for you, seeking to know God more, then you're worshiping. Some people use old hymns, others use modern songs, some use silence, some use walking or movement, and others still use stillness. I'm tired. I'm tired of arguing about what is real worship and what is not. I am tired of arbitrating comments and complaints about why hymns are better than songs and why what they're doing over there isn't real worship. None of us can make that statement. For none of us can see what is going on in a person's heart. And after all, that is all that matters. If when we gather we are worried about what we do or do not do, then we have somewhat missed the point. The point is that in worship we turn our hearts towards God. It matters not what the person next to us is doing, it matters not what those people over there in that other building are doing. Are we offering something that is of worth to a God who is worth absolutely?
Welcome to the Heart of Worship Online, an extended version of the new monthly feature on my BBC Radio 2 programme, The Sunday Hour, where I get the opportunity to interview a composer or a writer of sacred music to find out how they put together a piece of music, especially for worship. And my first guest of the series is singer-songwriter and worship leader Matt Redman, whose song, The Heart of Worship, inspired the title of this feature. Matt, it's just great to have you on the show.
Thank you.
So, Heart of Worship, what's that song all about?
I guess it's really about focusing on what it means to worship, what it's all about, what's the purpose of this. And ultimately, when I wrote the song, it was to say, let's strip it all back. We've got all this music going on, you know, we've got all these attempts to songwrite and start what this is all about. It's really just lifting your eyes up towards God.
I mean, now that song is known internationally, it really touches core of people when we sing that song, you really feel as if you are actually worshipping. But if you could just take me right back to the beginning, the real roots, and really describe what happened.
Yeah, it was an interesting song because it was actually written as a very personal thing for me, and I didn't realise it could be something that was congregational. I was at a church in Watford called Solside Watford, it's part of the Anglican Church. And we had this crazy little season where the pastor, a guy called Mike Benavarchi, he said, right, you know, we love to worship through song, but I think we should refocus a bit and make sure that we're not leaning on all the props like the sound system and, you know, who's leading worship and what songs. He said, so we're going to get in a room with just our voices and our Bibles, strip it all away, and check that we can still bring an offering to God. And, it, you know, this church is full of teenagers and young 20s, and it was a really kind of bold thing to do. To be honest, the first week it was a little bit awkward. It was like, and I was the leader, like, what's my job? You know, I used to be the music leader here, and I have nothing to do now. But that actually made me ask some questions, you know. What are my motives when I do this? When I'm up there on a stage, you know, am I doing this as a service, or am I trying to build my own little thing? You know, and it's really... It was a great moment for me as a musician and as a worshipper to refocus. And so I wrote this little song describing what happened. It says, when the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth, that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song. And then the chorus says, I'm coming back to the heart of worship. Like I said, when I first wrote it, I thought that was my little thing, but then figured out actually those words seem to relate to other people.
When you started out as a young lad, did you know that you were going to be a singer-songwriter?
No.
How did it happen then?
Well, I can't even read music, and I always like messing around with words. But it was my youth leader. He heard me singing and encouraged me in that. It was in a great church which encouraged young people to use gifts. And, you know, I started travelling around the country at weekends in different churches from about the age of 15, 16. And then this whole Soul Survivor movement took off, which was thousands of, and then tens of thousands of young people. And it just was a great moment to learn. You know, it kind of stretched you. You had to write songs to give them something to sing. You had to kind of up your game music-wise. So it was great. It was a great learning environment.
So how did you write your songs, particularly as you say you don't write or read music?
Yeah, I mean, it's instinct to me, really. And you know, now we're going to have to surround ourselves with musicians who know what they're doing, but just my approach has always been just to try and pour my heart out and try and let my mind guide it, you know, and I want the songs to be passionate but also purposeful. So I think sometimes songs can just be a stream of overflow and it's kind of unconscious, and there's can be a beauty to that music. I like a lot of music like that, but when you write congregational worship songs, it can't be. You have to be very focused, you have to think, because you're putting words into people's mouths.
I was actually going to ask you about that, the difference between writing a song, because it just flows out of you,
yeah,
and writing a song that you know people of all tastes and ages will,
yeah,
be singing, hopefully, every Sunday in their local church.
Yeah.
So what do you focus on? Do you focus on scripture, that, you know, that congregation? What do you do?
Well, I mean, firstly, it has to be real to me. Secondly, I do want it to reflect God well. You know, I'd like someone to sing one of my songs and think, oh yeah, that's describing the God that we read by in the Bible. You know, that would mean a lot to me. But also, it has to connect people's lives. You know, I remember something Bono from U2 once said about songwriting. He said, you can have 1,000 ideas, but without emotion, it's just an essay. So I don't want my songs just to be the cerebral exercise. I want them to be something that people can connect with and pour their hearts into it, and more than that, even that, oh yeah, this is relevant to my life. I've been going through this thing this week, and this song speaks into that. This song's a great prayer for me right now because I'm walking through this storm of life, whatever it might be. You know, I want the songs, the ones that have taken off the most, they've always been the ones that seem to connect with people's real lives.
Worship is about God and God's people. I don't think it's by accident that those songs that take off the most are those ones that connect with people and their lives. I do not think that it's by accident that those prayers that really connect with people are the ones that get shared. Worship is about connecting God with God's people.
and vice versa. In a moment, we're going to undertake a challenge together. But first, let's sing that song that Matt was talking about together, When the Music Fades.
When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come. Just to bring something that's a word that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within. Through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for
Bye.
we tune out the music, which, let's face it, is more than often the thing that divides us in our congregations. Is there a heart of love for God left? We're going to give it a go. In a moment, Alan is going to cycle through 26 slides on a PowerPoint. I hope they're on the email, Alan. One per letter of the alphabet. As those letters come up, what I want you to do is shout out words of love for God, words that describe God for you. So, for example, for A, you have Alpha, awesome, amazing. You might have some more, and so on. Let's just pour out our hearts. Tell God just how wonderful He is to us in this time together. I've done this exercise several times before, usually with youth groups. I think I might have done it staff meeting once as well. So I can confidently say there is only one letter that we have always had to get creative. And that's the letter X. But we'll see. You might come up with something wonderful. So, let's praise God together.
Adoration.
Adoration.
Amen.
Amen.
Amazing.
Amazing. Alan, just move them on when you feel the time's right. Don't wait for me to tell you next one.
Brilliant.
Beautiful, brilliant.
Blessing.
Creator. Caring.
Christ.
Christ.
Comforting.
Divine.
Dear.
Diligent. Extraordinary.
Enthusiastic.
Everywhere. Excellent. Everywhere. Exciting.
Elation.
Faithful. Faith.
Friend.
Family.
Fear.
Fear. It's an important one that often gets missed.
False.
Fantastic,
right?
Gospel.
Great.
Gracious.
Generous.
Glorious.
God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Good about that for A as well, didn't
you?
Hosanna.
Healing.
Healing.
Heaven.
Honest. Holy. Indescribable.
Incredible.
Some might say indisputable.
Immeasurable.
Immeasurable.
Justice.
Joy.
Jesus.
Jehovah.
Jesus.
King.
Kind. Kingdom.
Kingdom.
Night.
Light.
Light.
Loving.
Love. Loving. Lord.
Lonely.
Lonely.
I can't quite think about what it's like.
Yeah.
Majesty.
Majesty.
Magnificent.
Mary. Marvelous.
Mighty.
That is two words, never ceasing, but
nice.
I think God's a little bit naughty sometimes too. This is where I rely on the fact that God is neither male nor female, and I usually say that he's a queen as well as a king.
Righteous.
Righteous.
Royal.
Robust.
Receives.
Receives.
Regent.
Regent. Risk. Savior, super,
salvation,
supreme, and just a little bit silly.
Scared.
Scared, and sometimes a little bit scary. Shocking. Savior.
Tremendous.
Tremendous.
Timeless.
Timeless.
Trustworthy
teacher.
Tempter.
Universal.
Universal.
Universe.
Universe. Ubiquitous. He just throwing words at me now. I'm not sure I even know what that means. Victorious, victory.
Violent.
Vanquished.
Valiant. Vanquished or vanquisher?
No, vanquisher.
Vanquisher. Wonderful.
World.
World.
Worship.
Wise.
Worship.
Worship.
Wonderful.
Wonderful. Bit whimsical, maybe. Are you ready?
Cross.
Excellent.
Cross. Excellent. Exciting sort of done.
Xenophobic.
I'm not sure he's xenophobic. Perhaps he's a xenophile. Why? Yahweh? Yesterday?
You?
Today? Yesterday? You? Yours?
Zacharias.
We're on to it now. Zealous. Zacharias. Zacchaeus. How about somebody might say zoological?
Did have a
zoo. Did have a zoo, he did.
Back to Noah.
We are back to Noah. Indeed. I think we've done really well now. Let's pray together. Lord God, you are truly wonderful. Fantastically, amazingly brilliant. Someone who reaches out, touches all of our hearts in different times and spaces, just in the way that we need. For you love and care for each and every one of us. You do not treat us all the same, for that is not what we need. Instead, you treat us all according to our own need, for you know us all by name. You even know the numbers of hairs on our head. You truly are indescribable and zealous for us. And so, Lord, we come to you today with open hearts, and open minds, and open spirits. We declare that you are worthy. That you are great and holy, omnipotent, and that you are love. And as we come into your presence, we bring our awareness of our own misdeeds, of our own shortcomings and shortfalls. And so we pray that you would give us all the strength to repent from them, to turn away from them, to turn towards you, that we may become just a little bit more holy, that we may become a bit more like you. Lord, through our sharing in your presence today, would you bless us all with the strength and the courage and the forbearance to go forth from this place and not remain the same, to be transformed by you. For we already know, we are already assured that you have forgiven us, so help us to forgive ourselves, to move on. Lord, into your presence we also bring our worries and concerns for our world and for the people around us. And so, knowing that you are filled with love and compassion, care and kindness, wisdom and power, we bring these concerns before you now. We pray for a world on the edge, at the point almost of no return. We pray for a government that seems to be falling on its knees. We pray for countries at war, for those who are affected by violence and fighting of any nature. We bring before you our concerns for those who have nowhere to live or nothing to eat, whether we know them by name or not. And Lord, we bring before you today those we do know by name, who are ill, who are awaiting surgery, particularly Claire, as she prepares for a kidney biopsy on Monday. Particularly Oliver, who is an extremely unwell 8-year-old. If anyone else here wishes to name somebody out loud or in the quietness of their hearts before God, I invite you to do so now. Margaret, for Dad, Lord, for these individuals, we pray your healing hand and your caring presence be upon them, that whatever the future may hold, that you will be there. That you will walk with them just as you have walked with us, through the good times and the bad. We know that you are a faithful God. With these people, our most dearly loved, we trust you. We trust you, our King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And we cry, Hosanna, Hallelujah. For yours is the name above all other names. And as we pray together, shall we join our prayers by saying the words that Jesus taught us in whatever language or form we are most familiar? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We sing two more songs together. Here I am to worship. Here I am to bow. Followed by How Great Is Our God.
Here I am to bow down.
pray and sort of prepare to go. Lord, you are truly great, truly wonderful. We pray that you will continue to live in us, to whisper to our hearts and minds and souls as we go forth from this place to live a life worthy of your name, worthy of following you. Go with us this day and forever. In Jesus' mighty name. Just as a way of finishing together as we started by singing a song that began in another language. We are going to end by hearing the song The Blessing, which was written just before the pandemic started, written by Carrie Jo, sung by people from across the world in something like 256 languages. If you got in close to the wire, I need to give you one of these bits of papers because the words on the screen are not always in English. So if you want to know what they're singing, I'll give you one of these. But it is quite long. I think it's about a 7 minute long video or something. So don't feel like you have to stay for all of it if you don't want to. Feel free to get up and go whenever is right for you. May God bless you and keep you this day and forevermore. Amen.
Stay.